Welcome to the CMNtv interview. I'm your host, Chris Weigel, and today you've come on a fantastic day because we're going to be discussing food, what we eat, what we digest, what keeps us going. And with us today, we have a very special guest here in the studio, DJ Fat Albert Boswell. Albert, welcome.
Thank you, Chris.
How are you doing?
I'm all right. How are you?
Thank you for coming out. All right, let's get right down to it. What is your least favorite food?
Least favorite? I would have to say, hands down, tomatoes.
Tomatoes?
Tomatoes.
What did tomatoes ever do to you?
They have no consistency. They have just this mushy feeling in your mouth, and it just feels wrong, and it has no taste whatsoever.
No taste?
No taste.
Where are you getting your tomatoes?
You can't dip a tomato in ranch.
You can't.
And you can't have a good taste.
Do you want them to crunch when you bite them? Or
something other than exploding watery
Water. Seeds. Yes. Do you like the seed? No, you don't.
That's
like
a horrible taste.
Have you ever had a green tomato?
I have not had a green tomato.
Just the red tomato.
Yeah, and that was once. Just once.
Just tell me about that. When would you first have that tomato?
I believe when I was about 5 years old, I was forced to eat a tomato by my parents.
Like as a punishment? Or
no, just... I was sitting at the dinner table. It was sitting on my plate.
All you had for dinner, they had steak and potato.
It was just the last thing left on the plate.
Just a tomato.
Tomato. And I was told to eat it. And I said, I don't want to eat it.
Right.
I said, eat it. I put it in my mouth.
Yeah.
The consistency was just so nasty, and it had a taste. I instantly threw up.
You threw up all over the table.
Yes. And I said, see, I told you, no tomatoes.
So, like, what was the punishment that came from that?
Nothing. I didn't get tomatoes.
I didn't get tomatoes.
It was a lesson more than a punishment.
Now, okay. So you hate tomatoes. They literally make you gag.
Yes.
Other people, though, they think they're great. And why do you think, you know, some people like tomatoes?
I think they like that consistency in their mouth. I think some people like a bland taste.
A bland taste?
Bland. Some people just enjoy bland.
You've never been tempted maybe to, if you saw like some vine-grown tomatoes or like home-grown tomatoes, maybe try, maybe now is the time they're different. You're older now, probably better control of your stomach.
You know, that's what I thought until the other day when a tomato slipped into my food by accident, and I did not appreciate it. It tasted nasty, and it had me gag.
How did it, like, fell into your drink, or what?
No, it was in a sandwich. I told them to not put tomatoes on it, and I trusted that they didn't do it. Bit into the sandwich, tomato.
What happened? What'd you do?
Gagged.
Gagged.
Spit the food instantly.
Now, what would you say to somebody that's never eaten a tomato but is like, hey, Albert, I got all these tomatoes. I'm going to eat them. What do you say to them?
Good luck. Enjoy.
Good luck?
Yes.
You're not going to warn them?
No. They have to find out for themselves.
Are you going to like stay far away from them? Or?
I will not be around if they start cutting tomatoes and eating them because I do not like
just
the
taste cutting the
smell.
Tomato. Yes. Like, does it make you cry? Or what's the reaction you
get? No, it's just... it's nasty.
Horrible.
Yes.
Now, are there any other foods that disgust you?
No. Surprisingly, there's just the tomato.
Just the tomato.
I'll eat anything else.
What about like a cherry tomato? That's a candy from the garden, they call it.
Cherry nastiness.
Cherry nastiness?
Yes.
Oh. Ketchup of any kind?
Ketchup. Love ketchup.
Wait a minute. Ketchup is just tomatoes that have been...
No. Ketchup is tomatoes that's been processed and ran through all bunch of chemicals, and they get rid of all the tomatoy taste, and they add a nice ketchup taste.
Like a ketchup taste?
Correct.
So you like ketchup?
Yes.
Okay. Hate tomatoes?
Yes.
Spaghetti sauce?
Spaghetti sauce I'll do. No chunky spaghetti sauce.
No chunky.
No.
This is a very controversial position, and I got to commend you for your courage in coming out tonight and saying all this.
Thank you very much.
All right, well, Albert, thank you for joining us tonight. Thank you for joining us here at the CMNtv interview. I'm, of course, Chris Weigel, and we'll be right back after this. Welcome back to the CMNtv interview. I'm your host, Chris Weigel, and joining us in the studio tonight, Charlene Jeter. Charlene, welcome to CMNTV.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming out tonight. And you came on a fantastic night because our topic for tonight is work, what we do for a living. Charlene, what do you do for a living?
Well, I'm an actress and a model.
You're an actress and a model.
Mm-hmm.
Now, how did you get into this line of work? How did you become an actress?
Well, one year I was doing my bucket list, and I came across I wanted to do a bunch of stuff for the first time.
Okay.
So I came across this casting call over at Wayne State, and I never auditioned for anything before. So I said, I'm going to answer that casting call.
Okay.
So I grabbed the sheet, and I went in, and they had, like, every different room where you can cast.
Okay.
So at first I was a little timid and shy, and then by the end of it, I was cussing at people I didn't know, and I was just having a great time. Well, then I didn't expect anything out of it, but then I got a lead role in this one film, short film, and so that led me to another
time. What was the short film about?
Well, I had a stint where I was kind of a crack mom a lot. So that was my first crack mom.
You were typecast as sort of as a crack mother?
Yeah. Like, that was kind of funny. But that was my first role as that. So,
okay.
But I was a recovering addict who was trying to win over her daughter's heart, and the daughter rejected the character.
Okay.
So it was a lot of fun.
And how did you handle that role? How did it work out?
Oh, it was a ton of fun. I because I was in every scene,
yeah.
So I had to... And see, I didn't know anything about acting, so I got a chance to sort of sculpt the character and feel for and try to come up with all these different ways, try to be dramatic, not dramatic, and hold back. And so I just got the acting bug from there.
So when a scene came up where you had to be, like, really angry at your daughter, how did you pull that off? How did you bring those emotions up?
I was never angry at the daughter because I was desperately trying to win her heart, but I was angry at the father.
Okay.
So I would see first, I think the first scene when we had our sort of dispute.
Yeah.
First I come in and I'm trying to flirt with him.
Okay.
And then, of course, that doesn't work. So then I get really angry and we're yelling at each other. And
right.
It was funny because everyone on the set, they were like, thought we were really fighting. And it wasn't, you know.
Right.
I was just kind of trying to reenact something I thought that was supposed to be.
What were you picturing in your head? Like traffic jams or like stubbing your toe or?
Oh, well, I didn't do anything like the method ethic
or
anything because I didn't know that yet.
Right.
So I was just thinking of, I don't know, maybe things I've seen or heard, or
rage,
maybe people who have yelled at me in the past.
Angry cartoon characters,
yes,
things like that. Okay.
Yeah, exactly.
So that led to a number of other roles.
Mm-hmm. So I started auditioning for more parts and started getting in more things.
Okay.
And then from there, I just kept trying, but I would try for a lot of different roles, but then I just kept getting typecast as the crack mom. So then I changed my hair color, and then
How many films did you play a crack mother in?
Maybe about 10.
10?
Yeah, 10 shorts.
In the Metro Detroit region, there were 10 short films all focused on crack.
Well, not focused on. I wasn't always the lead role.
I'd
be like a supporting.
How did you keep from getting bored? Like, how did you mix it up and keep yourself interested in playing this role over and over again? What would you do differently?
Well, I dyed my hair and I started getting different roles. So
now
I get to be kind of like the demon.
Demon?
I've been a demon, yes.
You've been a demon, okay. How do you prepare for a role like a demon? Just, like, go out and commit sins or cause trouble?
Well, I do that every day, but...
Okay, so you have a lot of background ready to be a demon. Okay.
Yeah, kind of, but...
Okay. Do you feel that you're being fairly compensated for your work?
Not always.
Well, what do you mean?
Well, sometimes you do things for a trade so you can get the video, and sometimes you do it for a small fee or whatever, but... generally, because this is like not California and there's such a large pool of people accessible who want to do the same thing, people tend to do things for free, basically. So it's hard to get compensated the right way here. But right now, what I'm trying to do is take the reins for what I want to do.
Yeah.
Instead of waiting around for like a film or a photo or anything like that, I'm just kind of going out and just trying to make my way. So if I have to make my own film, if that requires me to write a script, which isn't always something you want to do, but you know, or get behind a camera and all that stuff, then I'm willing to do it because I need footage in order to take myself to where I need to be.
So taking control, it's a labor of love, but you got the goal in sight.
Mm-hmm.
And so now... crack mother, demon, and
I'm a romantic interest.
Well, it sounds great. I'd like to thank you for exposing us to this new world of acting, and good luck on your journey, and thank you for coming here to CMNtv Studios for the CMNtv interview.
Well, thank you.
Good luck.
Thanks.
We'll see you next. We'll be right back after this PSA on arthritis. All right, welcome back to the CMNtv interview. I'm your host, as always, Chris Weigel. And joining us for a very special, intimate conversation is our guest, Norlinda Murray. Norlinda, welcome to CMNtv.
Thank you, Chris.
All right, now, I know there's a wide variety of topics we could cover tonight, but we're going to focus in on just one of my favorites, leisure. So how do you spend your free time?
Well, there's so many things that I can do. And when I get up in the morning, I try not to plan my day because someone's always calling me.
Right.
The other day, someone called, said they were going in labor, and could I be in the room with them?
Without any warning?
Well, she had told me months before that she wanted me to hold her leg.
But you didn't know this was going to be the day. You didn't know waking up that was going to be the
day. So I wake up, I go to the hospital, and then they're inducing labor.
Okay.
So she's in a lot of pain, a lot of waiting.
Was it a long day?
Yeah.
Okay.
A lot of waiting. But then when the time comes, it kicked in, a lot of action.
Did you actually hold a leg?
I actually held
leg. Could you demonstrate? How do you hold a leg? Like, just hold your own leg. How do you do that?
Well, you don't want me to do that. No, because the knee to the chest.
Oh, knee to the... Oh, like that. Oh, of course. Right. Yes, of course. But is the leg kicking and like...
No.
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 Was there a lot of screaming in the room?
Actually, no. Because I had had a pep talk.
Oh, you weren't... you were screaming.
No, but I had had a pep talk with her. Okay. With the mom that was delivering. I had told her if she screams... It would suck the baby back in and take her longer to deliver.
9 more months of pain, yeah. Oh, my gosh. So, it went well, I take it?
It went well.
Okay.
Once the dilation came to 10, you know, you got to go 1 to 10. So, 10.
The doctor comes in the room?
The doctor comes in the room, and then they give a pep talk.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Is it, like, much more serious and, like, hard to understand?
Well, they're saying, okay, mom, this is what you're going to do. You're going to bear down. You're going to push as hard as you can. And you're in control. You're the one that's going to get this baby out.
Right.
So I said, now listen, I'm going to help you. Lift up the back. Got a leg.
Yep.
Push, push, push.
How long did it take from that point?
Well, 20 minutes.
Okay.
20 minutes.
Is that good? Is that, I don't
that
know,
was really good.
It's a good time? Okay.
Because sometimes people, they use the phrase, too plush to push. Meaning that they are too cute to push or don't want to push or
and
however.
That, what does the doctor do? Because you work in a hospital. What do they do at that point? They just figure, okay, you're not going to have a baby. You're just going to keep it in? Or?
There have been times where it's like, okay, she can't do it. It's going to have to be a C-section. But it could be like still at that point where she could have and didn't. And then C-section would. Cut it out.
So she had the baby. It was a beautiful, bouncing...
7 pounds, 8 ounce boy.
Oh, and the name?
Is Lamar Leon.
Oh, very good. Very good.
Yes, it was very nice. So as soon as the doctor takes the baby out, actually, the cord had looped once around the neck. So she said, oh, cord. Took it off. Pulled the baby out. Ugh.
Okay. Very dramatic, but it sounds like everything came out okay. Well, I'd like to thank you for this fantastic, interesting story. Wish we had more time, but we'd come back next time when we can talk more about, you know, what the baby ate or what it's going to grow up to be and, you know, if the mother's going to have any more children and what it is you like best about this activity. But I'd like to thank you, Norlinda, for coming out anyway and sharing your day off with us here at CMNtv Interview.
Oh, anytime, Chris. Thank you so much.
Very good. We'll see you next time after this wonderful PSA. Oh, you're over there. Goodbye.
Bye.
Welcome back to the CMNtv Interview. And you've come at a fantastic time because tonight we're going to talk about food with my very special guest, Nicole Galdi. Nicole, welcome to CMNtv.
Hi, thank you for having me.
Thanks for coming out here tonight. Now, Nicole, let's get right down to it. What is your least favorite food?
Well, Chris, it's a cross between French toast and scrambled eggs. I know you said one, but those are the two.
It's a tie between
those?
It's
a tie.
Oh, it's not like you put the French toast on the plate and then you put scrambled eggs next to it.
No, it's a tie. Those are the two foods I absolutely despise.
Those are two breakfast favorites. Why do you hate French toast?
I just don't like any dried egg. I don't like the taste of egg that's cooked.
Well, French toast is usually, I guess it dries out after a bit. And then egg itself is not necessarily dry, but you just don't like eggs at all.
I just don't, yeah.
Fried eggs?
What's a fried egg?
Poached egg?
I've never had a poached egg.
Hard-boiled egg.
I've had a hard boiled egg. Those are good with some olive oil and salt.
Those are the most egg-ish of all disgusting eggs. They smell like garbage cans, and they look like yuck. That you have no problem with. No. But scrambled eggs, no. French toast, no. So you don't have a lot of breakfast options, right?
No, and like pancakes I like, you know, but it has to have syrup or it has to have chocolate chips in it.
Oh, wow, that's a sugar meal. Okay, well,
Or strawberries or anything.
All right, well,
like
tell me about you must have at least eaten these foods, French toast and eggs, once, right, to get the... So tell me what was it like the first time you had those things?
Scrambled eggs my mom used to make for me all the time with ketchup, and, you know, I would eat it, wasn't picky, but just after a while, I just...
But that first time, did you have any sort of odd reaction to the food the first time you had it? No. How many times did you eat it before you said no more?
Several times. I don't know. Even when it comes to an omelet, like, it has to have cheese in it. Otherwise, I just don't like the taste of cooked egg.
Do you like chicken? I've heard, as I understand it, eggs will turn into chickens if you leave them alone long enough.
Yeah, I love chicken.
You like chicken?
Yeah.
But no eggs?
Unless they're hard-boiled or sunny side up. I like yolk.
Wait, that's kind of like a fried egg.
Oh, okay. I call it a sunny side up egg.
Right, okay. Well, why do you think that some people enjoy that egg flavor? Because I think I enjoy it. Why do you think some people do that?
I don't know. Everyone's got a different taste. Everyone has different tastes.
You think maybe something secretly, though? You think maybe something's wrong with them? Like, you kind of, do you judge them? Like, well, they eat eggs.
No.
They eat French toast.
No, I don't judge people.
No?
French toast is an interesting story, though. I have a thing with cinnamon. I'm not a huge cinnamon fan.
Okay.
And it was because when I was younger, we were on a trip, went to Cinnabon, and I got food poisoning from the Cinnabon.
Yeah. Bad experience.
Bad experience.
French toast. Even though you can put powdered sugar on French toast, not cinnamon, if you wanted to.
It's still that. It goes back to the egg.
Here's what you could do. I have the solution. Okay. No eggs, no French toast, big bowl of powdered sugar. Just eat that with your hands. Or push your face right into it. You know, at a big family meal. Have you ever tried anything like that?
No, but that might look wrong because it gets stuck places.
No, just all over. Ignore the rest of the people. Well, we only have a few seconds left. I'd like to thank you for coming out quickly, very quickly. Any other foods repulse you? Nothing at all. You'll eat anything.
Well, blue cheese.
Blue cheese. It is disgusting. Well, thank you, Nicole. Thanks for coming out. I'm Chris Weigel. Thank you for visiting us here at the CMNtv interview. Till next time, we're going to sit around and think about blue cheese for the next half hour. Goodbye. All right, welcome back to the CMNtv interview. I'm your host, Chris Weigel, and joining us today in the studio for an in-depth four-minute conversation, my friend and yours, Karen Lay. Karen, welcome to CMNtv.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you for coming out. Now, let's get right down to it. We're not going to talk about food or leisure. We're going to talk about the serious world of work. Karen.
Wonderful.
What do you do for a living?
I'm a fuel systems engineer.
Wait, say it slower.
Right, I'm a fuel systems engineer.
Fuel systems engineer.
Yeah.
So define each of those words and then define what they mean when they're all next to one another.
Okay, so I work in the fuel systems group at General Motors.
Okay.
So that would be your gas tank, your pump, your pipe,
okay,
the evaporative emissions system.
Okay, so what do you like just make, like, what do you do?
I'm responsible for evaporative emissions and pipes.
Okay.
On the heavy-duty trucks and the Corvettes.
So this,
as well as the Cadillacs,
does that mean, like, you pour liquid into tanks and then light it on fire?
Yes, actually, in testing, we do light... Actually, the most interesting thing in fuel system is testing. We do light tanks on fire.
Okay.
There is a test called a 2-minute burn test.
Okay.
Where we fill a tank halfway full of fuel, and it has to sit with a flame burning full tilt underneath it for 2 minutes. And
you guys just do that out, like, in an alley? Or
That's done in the lab. That's
okay.
A burn test.
Do you get to wear a lab coat? What kind of outfit? Like, are you scientists?
In the fuel labs, you know, it depends what you're doing. There are some tests that are fun. A lot of fun. Mud testing is one of the tests we do.
What is mud testing?
Mud testing, we are actually trying to see if we can seal up the system so it doesn't breathe. Your tank needs to breathe. If your tank does not breathe...
Does that mean you take a truck or a car or a person and you cover it in mud?
No.
Oh.
You take the truck, you have your system on it, and then you pretty much mud bog. We have a special mud,
now this
special
is,
consistency.
Is this indoors?
No, that one's outside.
That's outside.
We have a trough, then you mud bog. You drive forward at 30 to 40 miles an hour, swerving as much as you can, and then you have to do it all backwards. So it's a ride at Disney World, I'll tell you.
Now, how did you get into this career of damaging vehicles?
I got a job at DuPont and working in the paint lab.
Okay.
They paid for my college. They would pay for 2 degrees. They would pay for a chemistry degree and they would pay for a chemical engineering degree.
Okay.
So I said, okay, I guess I'm going to be a chemist because they were willing to pay for it and I could get a full ride that way. So I got the chemistry degree. Once I got the degree, became a chemist at DuPont for a short time and then got a job through a very interesting way, but over at GM.
Did you have an online resume of covering cars in mud and they were like, she's the one?
To be honest with you, I took a class in computers. And the guy sitting next to me was HR at General Motors, and he was struggling with the computer, and I'm pretty good at him. So I kept leaning over and helping him.
Because he didn't know what he was doing.
Because he was really struggling. And we went to lunch. He said, well, everyone knew everybody except for us. And he said, well, you want to go to lunch with me? Because we got all abandoned, and we went to lunch. And I happened to have a resume sitting in my car. And I said, you know, I'm going to give you my resume.
I'm going to help you use your computer all day. And then he was like, cover this car.
That connection, I got into GM.
In the remaining moments we have, are there any other careers that you have interest in beyond this chemical damaging?
Certainly, we play around with film. I'm in a couple of groups. One is called the 48 Hour Film Group. That's a hobby, but we make short films. We put them up on YouTube. We also are in a group called Bottom Feeder Films.
Well, that sounds fascinating. I don't know if you break things in that group like you do at your job. But I'd like to thank you for discussing your job, and I'd like to thank you for coming out tonight. That's all the time we have. Thank you, Karen Lee, for visiting us here at CMNtv. I'm Chris Weigel, and we'll be right back after this wonderful PSA on staring at the wall. Welcome back to the CMNtv interview. I'm your host, Chris Weigel, and joining us in the studio tonight is my friend, Tony Matar. Tony, welcome to CMNtv.
Oh, thank you.
Thanks for coming out. Now, tonight, I'd like to talk with you about leisure.
Ooh,
Tony,
okay.
How do you spend your free time?
Well, running. I do a lot of running.
You do a lot of running?
Running and biking.
What are you running from, Tony?
Reality.
Running from reality.
Yes.
And so, what is it about reality that frightens you?
Oh, it's not fright. It's a stress reliever.
Stress?
Okay. Oh, yeah.
And where do you run? Where is it?
From point A to point B and then back.
Is this outdoors or
treadmill? Outdoors all the time. Treadmill. Ugh. No. Hate treadmills.
Hate treadmill.
Boring.
Is there a specific path in the area you like to run on?
I have different paths. Like on snowy days, I'll go one way. Hot days, I'll go another way. You know, if it's a nice, sunny, cool day, I'll go a different way.
I mean, do you go to like a park or anything? Do a trail or?
If they're available.
Okay.
Normally, I like to do it like at noon. Around with a couple buddies of mine, we have what we affectionately call our nooner.
Okay.
We go out and go run.
Go out run. How long?
What's the distance? 3-4 miles.
Okay. And what do you like best about running?
Well, if I'm running with people, it's kind of nice. It's a social thing. You get to chat, talk. If you're not running with them, it's a good way to clear your mind and get a different view of the world.
Do you? Well, what kind of equipment do you need to go running? Do you use any?
Just a pair of shoes.
Pair of shoes.
Yeah, I'm definitely a hardcore runner.
Okay.
No headphones.
No headphones.
No headphones.
So just the sound of the environment.
You and your thoughts.
What are your thoughts like when you're running?
Well, a lot of times I'll be running and I'll run for like some days I'll run 10, 12 miles and I'll come back and I'll.
It's like
not remember where I was.
You lost the time.
That's right. Did I cross that street? I don't remember.
Is it like a transcendent experience?
Oftentimes it is.
Yeah. It's not like a blackout where you
kind of... Oh, no, no. A lot of times you go out, have an issue in your head, come back, got the answer. That's right. Come back and I know what to do now.
So you don't need any sort of special pants or a shirt? Like some runners have different outfits they wear.
You have to have clothes. Oh, yeah, definitely.
Like,
weather clothes if it's cold.
What do you wear to run when it's cold? Ear muffs?
Tights.
Tights, okay.
Yep, hat, gloves, mittens. Okay. Get these funky mittens that the fingers come off. They fold back so you can pull your fingers out.
Okay.
Get too hot.
Now, how did you get started in running?
Ooh, a long time ago when I was about 18.
Okay. And
I was getting too heavy. I went, I'm getting kind of heavy. Better start running.
Got to start running.
Use it for weight control. That's what I started. But then I got addicted to it. Now I can't
stop. What happens if you go a day without running?
One day I can do 2 days.
What happens after 2 days? Is like shaking.
Oh, I get the DTs. Oh yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Start to shake.
Like, what if you're in a position like, you know, you got trapped somewhere under a heavy object and you couldn't run? How long do you think it would go before you totally lost your mind?
Oh, probably about 2 days.
2 days.
Maybe 3 days. Yep.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I understand.
See, like this. See, I didn't run today because it was too snowy.
It's too snowy.
It's too slushy. So yes. Yeah,
What about running in place? Have you tried?
Ooh, can't do that. No.
Can't do that.
Bad for the knees.
You need like big strides.
Long strides. We had to run out. See, the best part of running outside is you say, "Well, I'm going to start going that way."
Okay.
And when you get far enough out, you say, "Well, I can't stop. I got to run all the way back." So you have to come back.
You have no excuse.
On a treadmill, you can stop. Oh, I'm going to do a mile. I'm done.
Turn it off.
So yeah, you run outside. Can't get back.
We have very little time remaining. Yeah. And how would you recommend this activity to others?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
And, yes. And how would you say, like, one sentence you were pitching running to someone, what would you say?
Oh, run for your life.
Run for your life. Fantastic, Tony. Thank you for coming out. That's great advice. I'd like to thank you at home for watching us tonight. We've had a great time. We've learned a lot about tomatoes and running from tomatoes and things like that. Thank you, everyone. We'll see you next time on the CMNtv interview. Thank you, Tony.
Certainly.